At the UN this week, Foreign Minister Winston Peters renewed his call for an immediate ceasefire in Gaza, in particular to allow aid organisations to work unhindered. It comes as the head of US aid warns a famine is already underway for some Palestinians in Gaza. Dr Ritesh Shah is a senior lecturer at the University of Auckland's Faculty of Education and Social Work. He led research projects in Gaza and is an expert in the politics of aid.
Look, it's an absolute tragedy on so many levels. But the thing that I am most worried about is the young people, the children, the future generations of Palestinian young people who I've seen time and time again have to weather conflict after conflict. You know, children who are 18 now have lived through six different conflicts. So this is just the latest in a long-standing set of tragedies there.
Samantha Power, who's the head of USAID, warns that a famine may have already begun in Gaza. Just give us a sense of how grave that really is.
Look, I spoke to colleagues who are in Gaza right now, and what I've heard that is in fact already the case. That's especially the case in the north, where there's very little aid making it in, but also in other parts of Gaza where there is incredible competition for the scarce amount of food that's available, and that's actually leading to a lot of internal conflict and violence, and that's not being reported. So there's a grave sense of insecurity, and again, the people who are most affected are the young people.
There are multiple agencies that are trying to get aid into Gaza and distribute aid throughout Gaza. But I want to focus on UNRWA, which is the agency which for some time now has been providing aid to Palestinians. The New Zealand government is still considering whether or not it will continue to fund UNRWA after allegations suggested several workers from that agency perpetrated the October 7th attacks. Several other countries temporarily paused and then restarted their payments to UNRWA. But what do you make of the way that situation has played out?
I think there's a bigger story here, and I think we need to look back to 1949, which is when UNRWA was established. And it was established to be there as a temporary solution to the issue of Palestinian displacement after 1948. They were never meant to be a long-term agency there to support Palestinians indefinitely. They have always supported and advocated for the right of return to people's lands that were taken, but that has also become incredibly political. In terms of the current day then, I think that we will probably eventually restart our aid, as most other countries have. But I think there's a bigger question at play, which is what's the long-term durable solution? And there are those who argue that UNRWA actually helps to sustain the occupation, that it enables Israel to maintain the status quo because it basically provides all manner of services to Palestinians who have been displaced since 1948, not just in West Bank and Gaza, but also in Lebanon and Syria, where, for example, the Palestinians have no rights to work or education if they are not citizens there.
Those are incredibly serious allegations, though, that people from UNRWA were responsible for the October 7th attacks. To be clear, New Zealand has continued to fund aid to Gaza through other NGOs in the meantime, but is it not a reasonable response for a country like New Zealand to pause payments to UNRWA or to, at the very least, investigate whether or not these allegations actually are true?
We're talking about 11 people that were under serious investigation out of a staff that they have of 30,000. So that's a very, very small percentage.
Nonetheless, the impact of those attacks is enormous.
Yes. And I think we need to understand that, you know, the employees of UNRWA, they are also people who live in Gaza and West Bank. They are Palestinians themselves, and they have lived through decades of the same conditions that they are also trying to mitigate and ameliorate. And so I think it raises a bigger question then of, can you expect humanitarian workers in any context to truly be impartial in a situation where you yourself are impacted by those conditions?
Are you saying that aid is inherently political, every dimension that goes into aid in these kind of circumstances?
Absolutely. And if we were to kid ourselves and think that humanitarianism is any different to other forms of aid, is, I think, beguiling the true reality of the situation. If we look, for example, at where humanitarian monies goes, it shifts based on the wind and where geopolitical interests are at play. 1 year it might be Ukraine, the next year it will be Gaza, the next year it might be Yemen. It has nothing to do with actual need. It has to do with the interest of the donors who are supporting those responses.
I just know that there will be some people watching this interview who feel that potentially you are justifying any alleged involvement of an UNRWA worker in those attacks, and those attacks were barbaric. So just to be 100% clear, what is your position there? Were those attacks in any way justified?
Absolutely not. Absolutely not. And the employees, if they were found to be involved, they will be sacked. And I understand that that is the position of the UN and UNRWA. And in fact, there is an agreement that the United States had as part of resuming funding to UNRWA in 2018, when it withdrew funding, that said that from this point forward, UNRWA had to show that its staff were impartial. They had to provide a list of all their employees to the donors, and they needed to all be vetted. So I think UNRWA has an incredibly big responsibility to try to show transparency of its staff and their allegiances.
Back to the politicization of aid.
Yeah.
In recent weeks, the US has done a couple of extraordinary things when it comes to aid in Gaza. They have parachuted in aid. They have endeavoured to establish a temporary port through which to provide supplies. But at the same time, of course, the US supplies billions of dollars in weapons to Israel. What do you make of a country holding both of those positions at the same time?
I don't think it's anything new. We need to look back at what happened with the invasion of Afghanistan in 2001. So we had the United States and New Zealand and other countries coming into Afghanistan to liberate the Afghani people, supposedly, and through military operations, and then on the other hand, providing education and providing humanitarian relief. And that has become an increasingly common practice of the melding of kind of development, diplomacy, and defense efforts together. I think the contradiction in the case of the U.S. is quite stark, right? Because you have Samantha Power, as you mentioned, who's there as the lead of the aid agency, saying, you know, this is a horrific situation, it's a catastrophe. And then on the other, you have Congress currently debating, you know, allocating $16 billion of aid. So $16 billion of military aid versus $150 million of humanitarian assistance. It doesn't even compare.
For 4 years before the war, you led a study into children's well-being in Gaza. So if you can go back in time to a time before October 7th, what was your impression of life and of the outlooks and prospects for young people in Gaza?
So the study looked at children's well-being over 4 years, and we were tracking things like their sense of hope for the future, their ability to regulate their emotions, their ability to concentrate on their schoolwork, so on and so forth. And this was in a period marked by the pandemic. It was a period that was marked by another escalation in 2021, but also just a worsening situation due to the occupation. What we saw were significant declines in all aspects of children's well-being. So, for example, in 2019, 3 in 4 children felt hopeful about the future. By the time we ended the study in 2022, this had fallen to 1 in 5. So a huge drop in children's sense of hope for the future. In another aspect, we asked children if they felt safe at home. 9 out of 10 felt safe at home in 2019. Less than 1 in 10 felt safe at home in 2022. So it just goes to show you the marked declines in children's well-being that was occurring even before the current conflict.
I mean, I was going to say, you'd hate to think what those numbers would be today, right?
Absolutely.
It would just be zero and zero and zero on every front. So how will the last 6 months then fuel radicalization in that generation, the generation that you studied in Gaza?
You know, it's an interesting question, because I think you can say, well, it's going to create a lot more grievances against the occupier. But I would say that there's also a sense that this is the status quo. And when you speak to Palestinians, both in West Bank and Gaza, I think in some ways what they feel is that this current moment actually makes things much more transparent. So it's as crazy as it seems to say at the current moment, there is a sense of not going back. And I think in a way that might actually offer some possibilities for hope, for thinking about things differently. And I wouldn't poise it as this is just gonna create grievances and new forms of radicalization. I would say that people are seeing possibility. They're seeing the idea that we can stop talking about the two-state solution. We can stop putting an idea that's no longer possible and viable off the table and actually call the situation for what it is. And I think for me, I have hope that whatever comes after this won't be a return to the status quo. That's why I don't think a ceasefire is enough now. I think what's going to have to happen is more than a ceasefire.
And what is more than a ceasefire?
I think thinking about coexistence. I think the idea of a two-state solution is dead. It's been dead actually since Oslo because what happened was that the Palestinians had very little control over most aspects of the territory they had. And that's been shrinking and shrinking since. They don't have control over their education. They don't have control over their tax revenues. They don't even have control over their water. So in a sense, it's a de facto occupation. It's not independence. And now this is making it clear what it really is. And Israel has said as much. Israel has said, we're not going to go back to the status quo. So the question is, what is the alternative? You've got to have people from both sides being able to live together somehow.